indeed. You are listening to KSER. Matt Anderson's in the house. Matt, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks
today.
For having me.
How did everything go last night in Olympia?
It was a great night. Yeah, my first time in there. And yeah, great crowd, lots of fun. Cool. Good as it gets, man.
Cool. Well, until tonight.
Until tonight.
Edmonds is going to be the best show ever, I'm telling you.
All right.
It's a great little building, and usually the crowds are very very vocal there. So
awesome.
Don't let me down, people. If you're going to the show, be vocal tonight.
Not too vocal. Yeah.
Not obnoxiously. And wait until the songs are over. You know, applaud between songs, not in the middle of them. All right, ladies and gentlemen, if you head out to the Edmonds Center for the Arts tonight, you'll hear something that sounds a little bit like this.
When the rain gets hard and you can't see the road, it don't matter where you go. Get out of the cold, you can come on in and stay with me for a while. I've got wood for the fire, soup on the go, the moon's coming up, you're a long way from home. You can come on in and stay with me for a while. When you're here with me, it's as safe as you can be. There'll be nothing but the sound of the rain coming down and my quiet company. Park by the road, walk up the drive. If I'm out in the garden, you can let yourself inside. Make yourself at home and stay with me for a while. Oh, you don't need to call if you're just passing by. The keys under the stone, the second from the right. Make yourself at home and stay with me for a while. When you're here with me, it's as safe as you can be. There's nothing but time, so ease your mind in my quiet company. The fire while you sweetly dream. You can close your eyes and stay with me for a while. You can close your eyes and stay with me for a while. It'll be just fine if you stay with me for a while.
Matt Anderson live in the sunlit room. That was fantastic. Matt is on the road right now supporting his latest release called Honest Man.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to take a look at that CD or any of the CDs that Matt has out, you can find all the information at his website. It's stubbyfingers.ca.
That's the one.
And of course, you can also find it wherever great music is sold, like Amazon, iTunes, all that stuff. So I got to ask you, this time around, this run through, you're only doing, three shows in
yeah.
Washington. How does a booking like this come together for you?
This one, you know, it's agents who really do all the booking stuff, but I think Shamik and I are on the same agency roster, so it's just, I think they have different ideas. The theaters kind of say, like, we'd like to bring this band in. Doesn't make sense for them to come to one show, so I think a few theaters kind of get together and make it so it kind of makes sense for everybody to come out and do it, and right. Yeah, it all just kind of lines up. It's a lot of people, you know, a lot of my people talking to their people kind of thing, kind of stuff going back and forth, and then we make it happen.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's like someone just shoots you an email and says, be in Olympia on November 1st by 7:30, and you're like, okay.
It's pretty much, you know, I get lots of stuff like, does this work for you? It's like, yeah, that works for me. That's great. You know, we don't, I'm pretty fortunate. I got a good team that kind of does all the legwork and all the discussion stuff, and by the time it gets to me, they just say, is this cool? And I say, yes,
I've done well over 200 of these sessions here at the radio station, and of all the people that I have dealt with, especially folks that aren't, you know, from the area,
right.
Matt is Canadian, if you didn't know, your people were by far the easiest to work with.
Oh, good. Good to know.
They were so easy. It's just, they just, if they had a question, they asked it, I answered it, they said, okay, we'll let you know.
Well, that makes
so,
a big difference.
So great to work with.
Yeah, good. That's good to know, because we have other times when it's not easy, so it's nice to know that it worked out.
In this instance, they were great with me. So, I was wondering, as you are a Canadian artist, and you have played all over the world, is there a noticeable difference to you in the audiences in the United States, Canada, or the other places that you play?
I find most North American audiences are pretty much the same kind of vibe, you know, but the same thing, you can have the same venue night after night can change. Different acts bring out different crowds, all that kind of stuff, and just different moods. You know, a Sunday afternoon crowd's way different than a Saturday night crowd. You know, it's just,
for sure.
You know, even between Friday night and Saturday night, people are just getting off on work on Friday. They're kind of,
right.
You got to work at them a little harder to get them into it. Saturday, people are geared up. So, but Europe is definitely a different kind of vibe. It's pretty intense when you play over there, and people show up. It's all about the music. You never have people talking through a show over there. Pretty rare.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of. A different conditioning, I guess, and it's what's crazy is that in Germany, like, you'll play and, you know, you'll have people, you know, most of my audiences, you know, with 30, 40, 50, 60, a lot of them, and we'll stand in a room, you know, shoulder to shoulder for 4 hours for a show, you know, it doesn't happen as much over here like that,
no.
They just, yeah, for them, like, they'll sit down for a jazz gig or a classical gig, everything else, they stand up, and it's just... They tough it out. It's pretty cool.
That's one of my biggest pet peeves around here is, especially during opening acts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it's a club show.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, to me, it's just disgraceful how people talk over the artist. It's like, you know, go outside or stay home and listen to records if all you're going to do is talk over
it. I don't understand it myself, you know.
I would never be able to understand how someone can plop down, especially like during the summer, if it's
mm-hmm.
an outdoor show, and they plop down $50, $60, $70, $80,
right.
and then talk through the whole show.
Yeah, you know, I get friendly chit-chat, you know, that kind of stuff happens. It's a relaxed vibe, you know,
oh,
have
sure,
people having drinks.
Sure.
Yeah, there's people, you can tell they're talking about their day. It's like, that's not what...
And,
you know?
And they've got their back to the stage.
Oh, yeah,
I mean,
yeah, absolutely.
It's like,
yeah.
What?
Yeah, that combined with people looking through their cell phones the whole show. It's like, I don't... Why did you even come out? You know, go drink and watch YouTube.
Is that a major distraction when you're on stage, to have 50 cell phones up in the air recording what you're doing?
For me, it is, you know, especially doing the solo thing. You know, I'm looking out there to make a connection with people, and it's the same if you're having a conversation. If somebody's talking to you and they put a camera in front of their face, you don't even see their eyes anymore, right? You know, so it's, yeah, it's kind of hard, you know, so you kind of, it sucks to have to ignore people in a room, you know, when you're playing, when you're trying to make that connection. So, yeah, it's a little disheartening sometimes, and maybe I'm too sensitive to it, but I don't know. I also think, too, they're missing out. You know, if you aren't actually, you're only getting half a connection when you can get something a lot cooler.
Right. I agree 100%. Mm. Although I, you know, because I am affiliated with the radio station, just about every show that I go to, I will take a couple of pictures. But generally what I try to do is I bring out the cell phone during the first song, snap a picture,
right.
then put it away.
Yeah. Because,
you know, I don't want to miss anything.
Yeah.
You know, because there's only, you know, people say, well, you look at the picture and it brings back the memory. It's like, well, if you weren't paying attention,
yeah.
there's no memory to bring back. It's like, oh, I remember taking this picture.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'm pretty sure before cameras came along, people weren't chiseling out pictures of shows they went to, right? You know, to remember it.
No,
you remembered shows. I mean, that's just, I don't know. I think people are using it. I don't know. Yeah, it really is. It's frustrating.
I think also, I think it's different for people of our generation, because I think we're about the same age. So, you know, we remember when we were young going to shows, and we went to shows because we loved the music
mm-hmm.
and the artist,
yeah.
and it wasn't a social gathering.
Yeah.
And we remember shows before cell phones,
mm-hmm.
you know, and when the craziest thing that would happen is we'd all hold up our lighters to
yeah.
show that
yeah,
we approved,
exactly.
you know, and the cell phone's not the same. It's,
yeah, I can't imagine
if
you went to see Elvis or the Beatles. And watching them through a phone and saying that compared to seeing them live, really,
exactly.
You know,
I mean, it's almost the same difference as actually seeing the show live as opposed to watching it on
mm-hmm.
TV.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can see everything, but it's not the same experience.
No, not at all.
Not.
No.
I was wondering, you know, you've been at this for over a decade now, mm-hmm. And as we said earlier, you play all over the world. Do you have a favorite place to play?
It's always great playing at home, and I know it's sure. probably just because it's home,
right.
but it has a vibe. You know, you're really comfortable. You know how to handle the crowd. You know, there's no guesswork there. It's just like, I don't know, it's like putting on a comfy sweater, you know, playing at home. But, yeah, you know, I have been fortunate enough to play lots of places, and every place has its own charms. You know, it's the first time I played England, it freaked me out because they're, I don't want to say reserved, but it's an extremely respectful
they're
listening
very proper.
Environment. Yeah, you know, when they're listening, you know, there's no hooping and hollering between tunes. We're here, you know, you play a solo and people are cheering for it. It's like, right on, you know, I just kicked ass. Over there, you do it, and it's like, I just blew that, it feels like. But at the end of the show, everybody's right there. They love it, you know. So it's just a difference how they show their appreciation. So you kind of have to learn how to handle different places and what they're going to, you know, how to feed off them, you know. But, yeah, as far as a favorite place, I'm starting to really dig playing in Europe. Like Germany, I'm having a lot of fun with the crowds over there. You know, even with the language barrier, still it's pretty fun. They're pretty intense, and it's just you say sing, they sing. There's no questioning. You know, they're right there with you from the get-go.
That's cool. I know I've talked to various artists before who had that same experience of playing in England, where you know they went back to the hotel room and were just like torn up. It's like, mm-hmm. wow, that's about the worst show I've ever played. It's awful. And then in the morning in the paper they read, brilliant new American artist, and it's like, oh, okay, I guess they had a different experience.
It didn't make sense to me until I played in a school over there, and the kids walk in, not a peep for an assembly. You know, they sit there, they clap when they're supposed to clap. There's no, it's just, it's, I think they're just kind of conditioned that way from, you know, when you're watching a show, you watch the show. It's
a whole different culture.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, but once I figured it out, you know, once I saw somebody tapping their foot and realized that was them on the edge, that you had them, I'm like, perfect. I got to figure it out. We're all good.
There you go. Is there any place that you know of that you'd like to play that you haven't had the opportunity to play yet?
I'd love to get to Asia sometime just to see what that's like. I think that would be cool. Yeah, other than that, I've been pretty fortunate to play in all kinds of different places, but I don't know, even with that, I mean, you can say you've played everywhere, but then there's some little club in some little town someplace that it's an amazing vibe. You know, so I've been, you know, I know little places like that at home for sure, but still finding new places like that all the time on the road.
All right, well, are you ready to give us another song now?
Sure.
This is indeed Matt Anderson, if you're just tuning in, and he's going to be performing tonight at the Edmonds Center for the Arts with Shamikia Copeland, showtime 7:30.
Darkest hour, she says you got to believe that you are special, believe you got a gift, the gift of life. Suffers, who lies, no matter who's wrong or who's right, it doesn't matter who started the fight. She says there's one thing you've got to keep in mind, believe that you are special, believe you've got a life is all you're gonna need.
gentlemen, Mr. Matt Anderson. That was incredible, man. So, you know, sometimes the hardest part about doing one of these sessions for me is not ruining it by singing along. I gotta bite my tongue. You go, oh, wait, I'm not listening to a record. All right, so the show again is tonight, November 2nd, 7:30 p.m., Edmonds Center for the Arts with Shamikia Copeland. Tomorrow night at 7:30 p.m., Mount Baker Theater in Bellingham. Matt is on the road right now behind his latest CD, Honest Man. Are there plans for a new CD in the upcoming year?
Yeah, just kind of after this tour is pretty much it. On the road for a little while, a few little runs, but nothing too big. And I'm going to be writing, really kind of getting some, getting in that mode, in the creation mode again, and probably recording in the spring sometime, and whatever happens after that, as far as, like, you know, when we hit the road. So probably the fall sometime next year, I think.
Yeah. So you can never be 100% sure how long it's going to take in the studio. You know?
Yeah, you just, I've learned not to set deadlines too far out.
Exactly. So for those of you that may not be as familiar with Matt's career, he is a two-time European Blues Award winner. He's won the Best Solo Performer at the Memphis Blues Challenge. In 2012, you won three of the Maple Blues Awards, mm-hmm. and four consecutive Maple Blues Awards for Vocalist of the Year. That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, it's a shock every time, for sure. There's some pretty massive talent up there. So,
my question is, how much do the awards mean to you? Because I know some artists say they're very important. Other artists, they don't even show up. They're just like, it doesn't mean anything to me. As long as I step out on stage and there's people mm-hmm. there, that's what matters.
Yeah, that's absolutely it. You know, it's cool to win for sure, but it's I don't put much weight into them. You know, it's the biggest payoff for sure is having people to your shows. And I'm in a wall full of awards and nobody come out to listen to you. Really isn't. You want it the other way around. I'd rather have no awards and fans, you know, for sure. So
exactly.
It's awards are kind of cool as far as, like, you know, you can say you won something. People think, oh, okay, yeah, that sounds cool. I'll check them out. But beyond that, I don't get too caught up in them, I don't think.
For you personally, is there a difference to you in winning an award for songwriting as opposed to winning one for the performance?
Yeah, I mean, it's different aspects that are recognized. I mean, it's one of the ones I won one year was Entertainer of the Year, which I was pretty proud of that one because I was a solo guy going up against a bunch of bands. So I kind of thought, okay, that's kind of cool. But, yeah, I mean, it definitely does. I mean, there's three parts of a performance. You know, it's the songs, it's the performance, then it's the talent, I guess, the singing, the playing, the kind of thing. So it's kind of nice to be recognized for all three sometimes. You know, I'm not sure how it would equate to other people, but, you know. You don't want to be just a guitar player, you know,
right?
You know, you try not to be anyway. It's nice to know that people can recognize all three things in there.
Is there a particular award that you would like to win that you haven't won yet?
No. I used to get caught up in that stuff, and you know, we have awards at home and stuff, and then I started to realize a lot of the awards I won I didn't have yet, but people who were opening for me did. So I thought they really don't matter that much. So I kind of started to not really get too caught up and realize that it's still about the music, you know.
Yeah.
The awards are there and it's kind of cool, but at the same time, music will survive without awards. You know, I don't think they co-depend on each other in any way.
So how old were you when you first fell in love with music? When did you start playing?
I grew up in a musical family, you know, on the East Coast. Back home, it's a big part of the culture for sure. So my grandfather played and my mom played, lots of cousins played. Every time the family got together, there was always some kind of music going on. And so you kind of just fell into it more than made a decision. And I guess I was pretty young when I started singing with my mom. And then grade 5, I think, I started school bands. So tuba was my first instrument. I was the only kid that could carry it, so that's why I got that. And then I played bass and drums through school and picked up guitar when I was about 14.
It's funny that you started off on the tuba, simply because just a few weeks back I had a gentleman here by the name of Freebo.
Freebo, I was wondering if you're going to talk about Freebo.
And,
yeah.
He was just here a couple of weeks ago, and he talked about playing tuba on all the early body rates.
Yeah,
CDs
yeah.
And I was like, wow, what's the chance? Two tuba players. That's pretty awesome. But that kind of leads into my next question, though. I think it's safe to say that you're probably best known for playing the blues,
mm-hmm.
But you can play a lot of different things and have played a lot of different things. Is there a different sensation that comes from playing the different styles of music, and is there one that just you inside appreciate more than the others?
Not really. I mean, it's kind of, for me, it's, I'd always quit, like, if you ate the same thing every day, you know, you want to mix it up. You know, you can love a good pizza as much as you love a turkey dinner, but you know, pizza every day, you don't want a turkey dinner after a while, you get sick of it kind of thing, right? So,
That's
yeah,
true.
there's so much great music out there, and I kind of grew up with all kinds of different influences. Blues is one that came later on more than the others did. You know, I grew up listening to lots of the old country my folks had, and gospel and classic rock, and then just kind of started digging into a few different things when I got older. And yeah, no, that's it's, I'm fortunate that I've got a career that I don't need to, you know, I'm put into the blues category quite a bit, but also that's widened so much. You know, it's pretty much all genres of music you can throw in
It
there,
seems to
really.
be these
You
days,
know,
yeah.
yeah.
Yeah, but blues and the Americana, it's like there's a fine line there because they both encompass so many huge artists.
Yeah.
And a lot of times you'll see the same artists in both categories
Oh,
these
yeah,
days.
yeah.
So, well, how old were you when you recorded your first record?
My first record, like 20, I would say, somewhere around there. Yeah, I just did like a 7-song EP kind of thing.
Do you ever go back and re-listen to it now? Or is that one of those things where you
I,
can't do it?
honestly, when I listen to it, I just hear a 20-year-old version of me. You know, my voice sounds like it's coming out of a little tiny head, and it's just kind of, you know, it's kind of cool to go back and, you know, at least I can see a progression, you know, and in the recordings, which is always cool to see. And for me, I don't go back. You know, I still get fans that do, you know. So
Sure.
yeah, it's definitely hard to go back and listen. I still don't have a, you know, it still changes from album to album, you know, what you do. So it's kind of cool to see where your head is at when you recorded something.
Now, this past Tuesday, of course, was Halloween, and as part of the Halloween season, I happen to be doing the Tuesday afternoon show. So I always do what we call the costume ball, which was 3 hours of covers,
Right.
and I played your version of the Bill Withers classic.
Okay.
Now the name just
Ain't No
escaped my head.
Sunshine.
Thank you, Ain't No Sunshine. Yeah, and I was wondering, as an artist, you're a pretty prolific and very good songwriter. When you decide to do a cover, what is it about the song that would attract you enough to say, okay, I'm going to do my take on this song?
A lot of it was just when I first do, like, you know, I started up the same way a lot of people did, doing bars and that kind of
Yeah,
stuff.
sure.
And when I started doing my own shows, you know, before I had very much of my own material, I used cover songs to fill in spots that I didn't have. You know, it's like, okay, I need another up-tempo song. What's a good up-tempo song to throw in here, kind of thing. And yeah, sometimes it's amazing how some covers can kind of take on a whole life of their own when you play them. You know, some songs I try not to play anymore, but they still always kind of creep back in there. And you going to Europe too, it's something that you know, I pull out a couple more covers out there than I would at home, for the most part, just because it kind of gives them a little familiarity, I think, because I know they're definitely not getting every word of every song kind of thing.
Right.
So.
Do you ever get requests from fans asking you to record certain songs that they love just because they want to hear how you would sound doing them?
Yeah, every once in a while people mention you should, you get lots of people saying you should do this song, you should do this song, that kind of stuff, which is always cool. It's nice to see where people kind of make a connection to you with the music they love, kind of thing.
Have
So.
you ever taken their advice and gone ahead and recorded one, or have you never done that yet?
None that I've recorded. I always listen, and sometimes it'll work
Sure,
its way
sure.
into a show or something like that. I don't record. I haven't had a cover on an album for a couple of years, but
Well, like I said, you're a pretty prolific and very good songwriter, so you don't need to.
yeah, I mean, it's sometimes, I don't know, unless I feel a really strong connection to a song for a cover, I guess I don't want to put it on the album. And also, it's kind of fun for the live shows, just throw different stuff out there. And
Yeah.
there's enough of it on YouTube. You don't need it on an album anymore. People can find it.
When you think about that, if you ever do, how mind-blowing is it to know that you've had 10 million views on YouTube? Over
Well,
10
I
million
figure a
views.
lot of those will probably be my mom, but it's
Still, 10 million. That's
yeah,
all.
no, it is. It's
That's
pretty.
no joke.
It's definitely. I think it's made the music world a lot smaller. You know, I can go to Europe and have people show with my full CD collection before I even show up to the gig, right? You know, we haven't bought it there. They bought it all online before because they've seen it online, got into it or whatever, and they bought the stuff. And people, you know, asking for songs they've seen on YouTube. You know, I get asked to do Ain't No Sunshine over there, whether they've heard me play it live or not, but they found it on YouTube kind of thing. And a lot of people will find a cover first and then get into your music and then come to the show. So it's, yeah, it's a double-edged sword for me, that stuff, you know. I think it's the worst way to see music, but it's also a really great way to see things you might not see.
Yeah,
You
exactly.
know.
It definitely is a double-edged sword. All right, we're running short on time, so can you give us one more song before we say goodbye?
Absolutely.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Matt Anderson, and playing tonight at the Edmonds Center for the Arts. Showtime, 7:30.
Don't you just listen?
Doing the title track to his latest CD, Honest Man. Will the copies of that CD be available at the show tonight?
They definitely will be.
All right, so you can get one if you're going to the show. If you're not going to the show, once again, the website is stubbyfingers.ca. You can get not only that CD, but all of Matt's CDs through the website. Again, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
It was a real honor and a pleasure for me.
Cheers, sir.
Anything else you would like to let the fans know before we say goodbye?
Nope.
All right. Nope,
I think that's good.
Well, once again, thank you for being here. Showtime tonight, 7:30, Edmonds Center for the Arts with Shamikia Copeland. And tomorrow, 7:30, Mount Baker Theater in Bellingham. Trust me, kids, you want to see these shows. Again, Matt, thanks for being here, and I hope that we'll see you again down the road the next time you
Absolutely.
Come to Washington.
Thanks very much, man.